students, good morning. In yesterday's class, we completed the lesson. As I told you yesterday, today we are going to discuss some important points or those points which are not mentioned in NCERT, but questions can be asked on those questions, or if you are solving some reference book, that these type of questions can be asked. So we will see some general things related to these topics, and after that I'm going to do the NCERT reading. As I told you, each and every line of NCERT, it is very important. So you should also know how to study the NCERT lesson. So whenever I will start the NCERT lesson, that time you also have to take your NCERT book and pencil with you, and you are going to mention whichever things I will explain to you in that. Fine. So let's see some additional points, okay, from this. So I have removed some important things or important points related to some questions which I saw. First one I found that is the smallest and largest number of chromosomes, okay. Which plant or which animal has least number of chromosomes, and which animal has highest number of chromosomes? So you just note down this. In plants, okay, minimum number of chromosomes, okay, minimum number of chromosomes are found in Haplopappus, Haplopappus, okay, Gracilis, Gracilis. Okay, this plant has only 4 chromosomes, so 2n is equal to 4. Okay, so in this plant, or this plant has minimum number of chromosomes, it has only 4 chromosomes, that is 2 pairs. And maximum number of chromosomes are found in Ophioglossum, Ophioglossum, Reticulatum, Ophioglossum, Reticulatum. This plant has 1260, that is 2n is equal to 1260. Fine. So 1260 chromosomes are present. If we see animals, fine. In case of animals, minimum numbers of chromosomes are found in one species of Ascaris. It is a roundworm, as you know. Ascaris megalocephala, megalocephala. This species has only 2 chromosomes, so 2n equal to 2. So there is only 1 pair of chromosomes, fine. Whereas maximum number of chromosomes are found in Holocantha. Okay, Holocantha, it is a giant protozoan. Fine. So in bracket I am writing, it is a protozoan and it has 1600 chromosomes. Okay, so 1600 chromosomes are present in a giant protozoan that is known as Holocantha. So this is general information, question may or may not be asked on this part. The next point, as I went through some questions from some reference book, I found this type of questions. Okay, so that I'm sharing this information with you. One question was there that which organelle it is said to be organelle within organelle. So these are the ribosomes. Fine. Ribosomes are commonly called as organelle within organelle. Organelle within organelle. Fine. So these ribosomes are called as organelle within organelle. The next point related to ribosomes only, that is the diameter of ribosomes. Okay. If you want, you can mention in this part wherever you have noted the ribosome part. So diameter of ribosome. So prokaryotic ribosomes, they are 20 nanometer in diameter. prokaryotic ribosomes are 20 nanometer, okay, that is 200 angstrom unit, whereas eukaryotic ribosomes are nearly 25 nanometer to 30 nanometer. So nearly 250 to 300 angstrom unit. Fine. We have seen with respect to S, that is eukaryotic chromosomes, they are 80S, whereas prokaryotic chromosomes are 70S. But if question comes with respect to diameter, fine. So the diameter of prokaryotic chromosome is 20 nanometer, whereas diameter of eukaryotic chromosome, it is in between 25 to 30 nanometer, fine. The next point I found, that is one concept, that is karyotype, and another one, that is ideogram. Okay, both these terminologies, they are related with chromosomes. Fine. We have seen that there are four types of chromosomes on the basis of centromere. That is metacentric, submetacentric, acrocentric, and telocentric. Fine. There is a significance behind these types also. So whenever we are studying a particular type of chromosomal abnormality, that time we have to study the structure of chromosomes. Okay. In 12th standard, we are going to study different types of chromosomal abnormalities. Okay. So how we will come to know a particular person is suffering from any type of chromosomal abnormality? So for that, we have to study the different or the 46 chromosomes in human being. So what we do, okay, we take out the nucleus, we take out the DNA, okay, DNA rather, we take out the chromosomes, and we take a photograph of that cell. Now when we take the photograph of cell, we can find these chromosomes which are present in cell. Now when we study this chromosome with respect to their morphology, with respect to number, with respect to their shape, so this type of study where we consider the morphology of chromosomes to study particular type of aberrations or abnormalities, that is known as karyotyping. So different types of chromosomal abnormalities are there. For that we have to study the morphology of these chromosomes. So for that we take a picture of a cell. From that we get images of all the 46 chromosomes from a human cell. We can study the size of chromosome, we can study the position of centromere, okay, we can study the shape of chromosome also, and from that we will come to know whether that person is suffering from any type of chromosomal abnormality or not. Fine. So this type of study of chromosomes with respect to their morphology, their number, their shape, position of centromere, size of chromosome, size of upper arm, size of lower arm, all these aspects we consider whenever we study the chromosomes. So this study, it is known as karyotyping. Fine. And graphical representation of karyotype or graphical representation of chromosomes, that is known as ideogram. So ideogram means what? It is a graphical representation. Graphical representation of karyotype. Fine. I will send you karyotype of humans, okay, so that you will understand what is mean by karyotype. Fine. So all the 46 chromosomes from human being, they are divided into 7 groups, okay, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. 7 groups are there. The 7 groups are made on the basis of their size, shape, and position of centromere. Fine. So there is and specific number, it is allotted to the particular chromosome, starting from the largest one to the smallest one. Fine. So there is a pair, that is a chromosome number 1, chromosome number 2. So I will send you image of ideogram of humans. Okay. So graphical representation of chromosomes, okay, that is known as ideogram. Fine. So these things are the very important important parts of genetic studies, right? The next point which I would like to discuss, yesterday we have seen that there are three types of microbodies, fine. From that, glyoxysomes, yes, these are also called as highly specialized peroxisome. So this point also you mentioned that glyoxysomes both are present in those seeds in which fats or oils are stored, okay. So glyoxysomes are also called as highly specialized, they are also called as highly specialized peroxisomes. Glyoxysomes are also called as highly specialized peroxisomes. Fine. One point I found in vacuoles, that how vacuoles are related with the osmosis in case of plant cells. Fine. As I told you, vacuoles play very important role in plant cells. Okay? About 90% area of a plant cell, it is occupied by a central large vacuole. Okay? So these vacuoles play a very important role in osmosis. Fine. So osmosis expansion of a cell, it is regulated by vacuole, because whenever cell is absorbing any fluid, that fluidity is stored in this vacuole. So vacuole play very important role in osmotic expansion. Vacuoles play very important role in osmotic expansion. Osmotic expansion of a cell. Okay, in plant as well as in animal cell, whenever osmosis takes place, the sap or that fluid is stored in vacuole. Fine. Now one question was there, that which enzyme it is present in abundance in chloroplast, okay, or in plastids. As you know that this chloroplast, they are involved in photosynthesis. Photosynthesis takes place in each and every cell which is green, which is filled with the chlorophyll. Fine. So for photosynthesis, the enzyme used, that is known as Rubisco. Okay. So enzyme Rubisco. I will mention its full form also. Ribulose bisphosphate or biphosphate carboxylase. Carboxylase oxidase. Okay, Rubisco, it is the most abundant enzyme on this earth because it is present in each and every cell of a plant, or each and every green cell of a plant. Fine. So most abundant enzyme on this earth, it is present in chloroplast. So Rubisco in chloroplast. This enzyme, it is involved in the dark reaction, okay, which takes place in the stroma or matrix. It is involved in the reduction of carbohydrates into sugar. Fine. So these are some points which I found. Fine. If you get some new points and if you are not able to understand those points, just send me those points so that I can include those things in my next lecture. Fine. Now I hope I tried to cover all points from this lesson. Now the important thing which I was thinking from so many days, that thing is that everyone is having NCRT, but I don't know whether you are reading that NCRT properly. As I told you, NCRT is very important for you. Each and every diagram, each and every labeling from that NCRT, even though the introductory part, information of scientists which is given at the beginning of chapter, questions can come from that also. So if we consider the biology NCRT, today I brought your biology NCRT over here. And I just want to show you how to read the NCRT and in what way. Whenever you read the NCRT, you have to think that any way or in any way, question can ask on each and every word. Okay, so in this way, you have to generate this habit in you. Proper reading, frequently you have to read this lesson. Right now we are learning the cell lesson, but in your planning, you should give certain time to the previous lessons also. You have to read those lessons frequently. Fine, huh? So today we will do NCERT reading for the cell lesson. Once you understood how to study the NCERT, then I hope for next lesson you will study, because for major test, definitely questions will be there, line to line questions will be there. Fine. So for that, you have to read. I told you at the beginning. So here also at the beginning of cell unit, S. Ramachandran, okay, G. N. Ramachandran, scientist information it is given, okay, so that also you have to read, okay, his publications, his contribution, okay, all the things you have to read. Questions can come from this part also, okay, so let's start. Along with me, you will also read. Fine, so just open your NCERT and go through the textual content. Fine, so today we are going to do NCERT reading for cell lesson. I know it will take time, but as you have your upcoming major test, and for major test cell as well as cell division, both the lessons are very important. In class also we do NCERT reading compulsory. It's most, you should understand meanings of NCERT word. Okay, some words maybe I have not used for this. So for that you should know meanings of those terms. Okay, chalo, so let's start. Some things, or if I need this, some part it is not important, so that I can skip. So when you look around, you see both living and non-living things. You must have wondered and asked yourself, what is it that makes an organism living, or what is it that animate this does not have, which a living thing has? The answer to this is the presence of basic unit of life, that is the cell, in all living organisms. In first lesson only, we have seen that the basic characteristic feature of all living organisms, that is presence of cell. Okay, the basic demarcation between living and non-living, all living organisms are composed of cell, all non-living organisms, they do not have cells. All organisms are composed of cells. Some are composed of a single cell and are called unicellular organisms, while others, like us, composed of many cells, which are called multicellular. So at the beginning of lesson only we have studied organisms could be classified as unicellular organisms and multicellular organisms. Next paragraph, what is a cell? Unicellular organisms are capable of, first one, independent existence and performing the essential functions of life. Anything less than a complete structure of a cell does not ensure independent living. Hence, cell is the fundamental structural and functional unit of living organisms. Here, one type of question which is asked commonly in all exams, that is, which of the following it is correct, which of the following is incorrect, which of the following it is not incorrect, which of the following it is not correct. So for that they give NCERT statement and they change one or two words from that. So for that you must have read NCERT properly. Fine. In 1838, Matthias Schildon, a German botanist, examined a large number of plants and observed that all plants are composed of different kinds of cells which form tissues of plants. Already we have learned this. At about the same time, Theodor Schwann in 1839, which was a British zoologist, studied different types of animal cells and reported that cells had a thin outer layer, which today known as plasma membrane. Okay. He also concluded, based on his studies on plant tissues, that presence of cell wall is a unique character of plant cells. On the basis of this, Schwann proposed the hypothesis that bodies of animals and plants are composed of cells and products of cells. Schildon and Schwann together formulated the cell theory. This theory, however, did not explain as to how new cells were formed. Rudolf Virchow in 1855 first explained that cells divided into new cells are formed from pre-existing cells, that is omnicellular, cellular. He modified the hypothesis of Sheldon and Schwann to give a cell theory a final shape. Cell theory as understood today is all living organisms are composed of cells and products of cells. All cells arise from pre-existing cells. Okay, so all these statements are very easy to understand. I hope you won't get any doubt in this because already these things we have learned. Next, you have earlier observed cells in an onion peel. In your school days, you might have seen the peel of onion under the microscope and or a human cheek cell under microscope. Let us recollect their structure. The onion cell, which is a typical plant cell, has a distinct cell wall as its outer boundary, and just within it is the cell membrane. The cells of human cheek has an outer membrane as the delimiting structure called structure of cell. Inside, each cell is a dense membrane bound structure called nucleus. These nucleus contain the chromosome, which in turn contain the genetic material, that is DNA. Cells that have membrane bound nuclei are called eukaryotic, whereas cells that lack a membrane bound nucleus are prokaryotic. In both prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells, a semi-fluid matrix called cytoplasm occupies the volume of a cell. The cytoplasm is a living main arena of cellular activities in both plants and animal cells. Students, many times this sentence has asked for MCQ, that which of the following or which is the main site of cellular activities. Various chemical reactions occur in it to keep the cell in the living state. Besides the nucleus, eukaryotic cells have other membrane bound distinct structures called organelles, like endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi complex, lysosomes, mitochondria, microbodies, and vacuoles. The prokaryotic cells lack such membrane-bound organelles. Ribosomes are non-membrane-bound organelles found in all cells, both eukaryotic as well as prokaryotic. Within the cell, ribosomes are found not only in cytoplasm but also within two cell organelles, that is chloroplast in plants and mitochondria and on rough endoplasmic reticulum. Again, this statement, it is important for MCQ. Animal cells contain another non-membrane bound organelle called centrosome, which help in cell division. Cells differ greatly in size, shape, activities. For example, mycoplasma, the smallest cells, are only 0.3 micrometer in length, while bacteria could be 3 to 5 micrometer. The largest isolated single cell is the egg of ostrich. Among multicellular organisms, human RBCs are about 7 micrometer in diameter. Nerve cells are some of the longest cells. Cells also vary greatly in their shape. They may be disc-like, polygonal, columnar, cuboidal, tail-like, or even triangular. The shape of a cell may vary with function they perform. Now, just above this paragraph, that is figure 8.1, some diagrams are given. These diagrams are very important. You have to see the name of the diagram or which type of cells are given. They have shown different types of shapes. For example, a red blood cell, these are round and biconcave. White blood cell, these are amoeboid. Then your columnar epithelial cell, long and narrow. The longest cell, that is a nerve cell, branched and long. A tracheid in plant, that is the elongated one. Mesophyll cell, round and oval. Question can be asked in any way. Either they can give you the diagram to identify this, or what type of nucleus, or what could be the shape of nucleus. Fine, there. The prokaryotic cells are represented by bacteria. ब्लू ग्रीन अलगी, माइकोप्लाज्मा एंड पीपीएलओ, दैट इज प्लूरो न्यूमोनिया लाइक ऑर्गेनिजम्स. दे आर जनरली स्मॉलर एंड मल्टीप्लाई मोर रैपिडली देन यूकैरियोटिक सेल्स. They may vary greatly in shape and size. The four basic shapes of bacteria, bacillus rod-like, coccus spiracle, vibrio comma shape, and spirillus spiral, that already we have learned in our previous lecture, in your previous lesson. The organization of prokaryotic cell is fundamentally similar, even though prokaryotes exhibit a wide variety of shapes and functions. All prokaryotes have a cell wall surrounding the cell membrane except in mycoplasma. The fluid matrix filling the cell is cytoplasm. There is no well-defined nucleus. The genetic material is basically naked, not enveloped by a nuclear membrane. In addition to the genomic DNA, that is a single chromosome, which is a circular DNA, many bacteria have small circular DNA outside the genomic DNA. These small circular DNA are called as plasmids. The plasmid DNA confers certain unique phenotypic characters to such bacteria. Phenotypic means morphological, okay, or which we observe, okay, external characters. Phenotypic characters to such bacteria, one such character is resistant to antibiotic. In higher classes, you will learn that this plasmid DNA, it is used to monitor the bacterial transformation with foreign DNA. As I told you, this plasmid DNA are used extensively in recombinant DNA technology to carry a foreign DNA into host plant, that we know as transgenics or transgenic plants and animals, okay. Prokaryotes have something unique in the form of inclusions, a specialized differentiated form of cell membrane called mesosome is the characteristic of prokaryotes. They are essentially infoldings of cell membrane. Fine. Now just aside to this, figure 8.2 is given. A typical eukaryotic cell size is about 10 to 20 micrometer. Typical bacteria 1 to 2 micrometer, PPLO about 1 micrometer, and viruses 0.02 to 0.2 micrometer. Fine, this also you have to remember. For us, each and every diagram with each and every tagging is important. Next one. Most prokaryotic cells, particularly bacterial cells, have a chemically complex cell envelope. The cell envelope consists of a tightly bound three-layer structure. That is the outermost glycocalyx, followed by the cell wall and then plasma membrane. Although each layer of envelope performs distinct function, they act together as a single protective unit. Bacteria can be classified into two groups on the basis of differences in the cell envelope and the manner in which they respond to the staining procedure developed by Gram. Okay, this already we have learned in Monera of biological classification. Those that take up the Gram stain are Gram positive, and the others that do not are called Gram negative. Glycocalyx differ in composition and thickness among different bacteria. It could be loose sheet called as slime layer in some, while in others it could be thick and tough, that is known as capsule. So whenever this glycocalyx, it is thin, it is loose, it is known as slime layer, and whenever it is tough and thick, that is known as capsule. The cell wall determines the shape of cell and provides a strong structural support to prevent the bacteria from bursting or collapsing. Right? The plasma membrane is selectively permeable in nature and interacts with the outside wall. Now while studying the plasma membrane, I have explained that plasma membrane, it could be impermeable, it could be semi-permeable, or it could be selectively permeable. Permeable means it allows any type of material to move across it. Okay, semi-permeable means only for the solutes, okay, so some substances, and selectively permeable means only those substances which are required by cell. Okay, a special membranous structure, it is mesosome, which is formed by extensions of plasma membrane into cell. These extensions are in the form of vesicles, tubules and lamellae. They help this in the cell wall formation, DNA replication and distribution of daughter cells. Fine, so already we have learned this. They also help in respiration, secretion process to increase the surface area of plasma membrane and enzymatic content. Very important points, line to line statements can be asked. In some prokaryotes like cyanobacteria, there are other membranous extension into cytoplasm called as chromatophores, which contain pigments. Fine. Bacterial cells may be motile or non-motile. If motile, they have thin filamentous extensions from their cell wall called as flagella. Bacteria show a range in the number and arrangement of flagella. A bacterial flagellum is composed of three parts, that is filament, hook and basal body. The filament is the longest portion and extends from cell surface to outside. Besides flagella, there are pili and fimbri are also surface structures of bacteria but do not play role in the motility. The pili are elongated tubular structure made up of special protein. The fimbri are small bristle-like fibers sprouting out of a cell. In some bacteria, they are known to help attach the bacteria to rocks in stream and also to the host tissues. Fine. Next, in prokaryotes, ribosomes are associated with the membrane, plasma membrane of a cell. They are about 15 nanometer by 20 nanometer in size, means nearly about 15 to 20 nanometer in size, and they are made up of two subunits, that is 15S and 30S. Okay, so they are associated with the plasma membrane of cell. This point you have to remember. Question can be asked that ribosomes are associated with the plasma membrane of a cell. They are of which type or what is their size. So you have to consider that ribosomes which are associated with the plasma membrane of cell, they are prokaryotic ribosomes and they have size of 15 nanometer to 20 nanometer. Right? They are made up of two subunits, that is 50S and 30S subunit, which when present together form 70S prokaryotic ribosomes. Ribosomes are the site of protein synthesis. Several ribosomes may attach to a single mRNA and form a chain that is known as polyribosomes or polysome. These polyribosomes are also called as ergazome. So you can mention over here, they are also known as ergazomes. Fine. So these polyribosomes or polysomes, they are also called as ergazomes. Fine. The ribosomes of a polysome translate the mRNA into proteins. Next one, inclusion bodies. Inclusion bodies means along with cell organelle, there are some stored food, okay, or some other materials are also present. They are known as inclusion bodies. So reserve material in prokaryotic cells are stored in the cytoplasm in the form of inclusion bodies. These are not bound by any membrane system and are lie free in cytoplasm. Example, phosphate granules, cyanophycian granule and glycogen granules. Gas vacuoles are found in blue-green and purple and green photosynthetic bacteria. Right? From this question can be asked that which are the cell or the which are the inclusion bodies in prokaryotic cells. Which of the following it is not inclusion body? So inclusion bodies are phosphate granules, cyanophycian granules and glycogen granules. Fine. So this is about prokaryotic cell. Next, eukaryotic cells. The eukaryotes include all protists, plants, animals and fungi. In eukaryotic cells, there is an extensive compartmentization of cytoplasm through the presence of membrane-bound organelles. Eukaryotic cells possess an organized nucleus with a nuclear envelope. In addition, eukaryotic cells have a variety of complex locomotory and cytoskeletal structures. Their genetic material is organized into chromosomes. So we know this point. All eukaryotic cells are not identical. Plant and animal cells are different as the former possess cell walls, plastids and large central vacuole which are absent in animal cells. On the other hand, animal cells have centrioles which are absent in almost all plants. Now after that, two diagrams are given here on this page, structure of plant cell, structure of animals. Obviously, if these diagrams will come in exam, same diagrams will be given here. So you have to see all the labeling. They can ask you any of this label. They can just mark A, B, C, D, or they can ask you function of this part. So study both these diagrams properly. Fine. Now, next one. Let us now look at the individual cell organelle to understand their structure and function. So first one, cell membrane. The detailed structure of the membrane was studied only after the advent of electron microscope in 1950s. Meanwhile, chemical studies on the cell's membrane, especially in the human RBCs, enabled the scientists to reduce the possible structure of enabled scientists to deduce the possible structure of plasma membrane. These studies showed that the cell membrane is mainly composed of lipids and proteins. The major lipids are phospholipids that are arranged in bilayer. Also, the lipids are arranged within the membrane with the polar head toward the outer sides and hydrophobic tail toward the inner part. This ensures that the non-polar tail of saturated hydrocarbon is protected from aqueous environment. In addition to phospholipids, membranes are also contain cholesterol that we have seen to provide the stability to the cholesterol. At certain places, cholesterol it is attached. Later, biochemical investigation clearly revealed that cell membranes also possess proteins and carbohydrates. The ratio of protein and lipid varies considerably in different cell types. In human beings, the membrane of erythrocyte has approximately 52% of protein and 40% lipids. Depending on the ease of extraction, membrane proteins can be classified as integral and peripheral. Peripheral proteins lie on the surface of membrane, while integral proteins are partially or totally buried on the membrane. Again, you have to study this diagram of membrane along with all the labels. Next. An improved model of structure of cell membrane was proposed by Singer and Nicholson in 1972, widely accepted as fluid mosaic model. According to this, the quasi-fluid nature of lipid enables lateral movement of proteins within the overall bilayer. This ability to move within the membrane is major at fluidity. For MCQ, very important statement. This statement has asked many times. The quasi-fluid means that is a semi-fluid or the quasi-fluid nature of lipid enables the lateral movement. As I told you, the nature of membrane, it is like iceberg floating on water or the gulab jamun floating on the concentrated solution of sugar. So because of semi-fluid nature or the quasi-fluid nature of cell membrane, proteins can enable to move laterally. As they are floating, they can change their position, okay, and they can just float over on the surface. So this property, it is known as fluidity. This ability to move within the membrane is measured as fluidity. The fluid nature of membrane is also important from the point of view of functions like cell growth, formation of intercellular junctions, secretions, endocytosis, cell divisions, etc. One of the most important functions of plasma membrane is the transport of molecules across it. The membrane is selectively permeable to some molecules present on either side of it. Many molecules can move briefly across the membrane without any requirement of energy. This is called as passive transport. Neutral solutes may move across the membrane by process of simple diffusion along the concentration gradient, that is from higher concentration to the lower concentration. Water may also move across this membrane from higher to lower concentration. Movement of water by diffusion is called as osmosis. We have seen all this part in detail. As the polar molecules cannot pass through non-polar lipid bilayer, they require a carrier protein of the membrane to facilitate their transport across the membrane. A few ions or molecules are transported across the membrane against their concentration gradient, that is from lower to higher concentration. Such a transport is an energy dependent process in which ATP is utilized, and it is called active transport. Example, sodium potassium pump. There are so many pump. There is only sodium pump, only potassium pump, sodium potassium pump, calcium pumps. Okay. Next, cell wall. As you may recall, a non-living rigid structure called cell wall forms an outer covering for the plasma membrane of fungi and plants. Cell wall not only gives shape to the cell and protect the cell from mechanical damage and infection, it also helps in cell-to-cell interaction and provides barrier to undesirable macromolecules. Algae have cell wall made of cellulose, galactins, mannans and minerals like calcium carbonate, while in other plants it consists of cellulose, hemicellulose, pectins and proteins. The cell wall of a young plant cell, it is a primary wall, it's capable of growth. Again, important point for MCQ, so many times this statement has come, which wall of the, or which layer of cell wall it is capable of growth. So that is the primary wall. So primary wall is capable of growth, which gradually diminishes as the cell matures, and secondary wall it is formed on the inner side. This also come whether it is formed on the inner side of primary or whether it is formed on the outer side. So secondary wall, obviously it forms on the inner side of primary wall. As cell matures and the secondary wall it is formed on the inner, that is toward the membrane side of a cell. The middle lamella is a layer mainly of calcium pectin, which holds or glues the different neighboring cells together. The cell wall and middle lamella may be traversed by plasmodesmata, which connect the cytoplasm of neighboring cells. Fine. Next, endomembrane system. While each of the membranous organelle is distinct in terms of its structure and function, many of these are considered together as an endomembrane system because their functions are coordinated. Why they are called as endomembrane system? Because their functions are coordinated. The endomembrane system include endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi complex, lysosomes and vacuoles. Since the function of mitochondria and chloroplasts as well as here peroxisomes are not coordinated with above components, these are not considered as part of endomembrane system. Next, endoplasmic reticulum. Electron microscopic studies of eukaryotic cells reveal the presence of a network or reticulum of tiny tubular structures scattered in the cytoplasm, that is called endoplasmic reticulum. Hence, ER divides the intracellular space into two distinct compartments, luminal, that is inside the ER, and extraluminal cytoplasm compartments. The ER often shows ribosomes attached to their outer surface. The endoplasmic reticulum bearing ribosomes on their surface is called rough endoplasmic reticulum. In the absence of ribosomes, they appear smooth and are called smooth endoplasmic reticulum. RER is frequently observed in those cells actively involved in protein synthesis and secretion. They are extensive and continuous with outer membrane of nucleus. So rough endoplasmic reticulus, it is in the continuation with nuclear membrane. Point to be remembered. Fine. The smooth endoplasmic reticulum is the major site of synthesis of lipid. In animal cell, lipid like steroidal hormones are synthesized in smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Again, diagram of endoplasmic reticulum, which is shown just aside to this. figure number 8.5. Again, you have to study this, all the parts. Next one, Golgi apparatus. Camillo Golgi in 1898 first observed densely stained reticular structures near the nucleus. These were later named Golgi bodies after him. They consist of many flat disc-shaped sacs or cisternae of 0.5 micrometer to 1 micrometer diameter. These are stacked parallel to each other. Varied number of cisternae are present in Golgi complex. The Golgi cisternae are concentrically arranged near the nucleus with distinct convex or cis or forming phase and concave trans or maturing phase. The cis and trans phase of organelle are entirely different but are coordinated. The Golgi apparatus principally performs the function of packaging of material. Mostly questions will come on this part. Many times you need questions asked on these functions of Golgi bodies. Fine. The Golgi apparatus principally perform the function of packaging of material to be delivered either to the intracellular targets or secreted outside the cell. Materials to be packaged in the form of vesicles from ER fuse with the cis phase of Golgi apparatus and move toward the maturing phase. This explains why the Golgi apparatus remain in close association with endoplasmic reticula. A number of proteins synthesized by ribosomes on the endoplasmic reticulum are modified in the cisternae of Golgi apparatus before they are released from its surface. Next statement is very important. Golgi apparatus is the important site for formation of glycoproteins and glycolipids. So, glycosylation of proteins and lipids. Next one, lysosomes. These are membrane-bound vesicular structures formed by the process of packaging in the Golgi apparatus. The isolated lysosomal vesicles have been found to be very rich in almost all types of hydrolytic enzymes. So they are commonly known as acid hydrolase, that already we have seen. Lipase, protease, carboxylase, optimally active as acidic pH. So this point is important. These enzymes are active at acidic pH. So just mention there, acidic pH nearly about 5. So that is not mentioned in NCERT. So you just mentioned that point, that enzymes of lysosomes, they are mostly functional at acidic pH, which is nearly 5. These enzymes are capable of digesting carbohydrates, proteins, lipids and nucleic acids. Next one, vacuoles. The vacuole is a membrane bound space found in the cytoplasm. It contains water, sap, excretory products and other materials not useful for the cell. The vacuole, it is bound by a single membrane which is called as tonoplast. In plants, the vacuoles can occupy up to 90% of volume of cell. In plants, the tonoplast facilitates the transport of number of ions and other materials against concentration gradient into vacuole. Hence, their concentration is significantly higher in the vacuoles than in cytoplasm. As I discussed now, cytoplasm play very important role in osmosis. Why? Because this tonoplast facilitate transport of number of ion and other materials against the concentration gradient. So they are packed, or the vacuoles are packed with number of ions. Fine. In amoeba, contractile vacuole is important for osmoregulation as well as for excretion. In many cells, as in proteus, food vacuole are formed by engulfing the food particles. Next cell organelle, mitochondria. Mitochondria, unless specially stained, are not easily visible under microscope. So which stain it is used? That is Janus Green B. Fine. The number of mitochondria per cell is variable depending on the physiological activity of the cell. In terms of shape and size also, considerable degree of variability is observed. Typically, it is sausage-shaped or cylindrical, having a diameter of 0.2 to 1 micrometer with average diameter of 0.5 micrometer and length 1 to 4.1 micrometer. Each mitochondria is a double membrane bound structure with the outer membrane and inner membrane dividing its lumen distinctly into two aqueous compartments, that is the outer compartment and inner compartment. The inner compartment is filled with dense homologous substance called matrix. Outer compartment forms a continuation limiting boundary of organelle. The inner membrane forms number of infoldings called cristae. Toward the matrix, the cristae increase the surface area. The two membranes have their own specific enzymes associated with mitochondrial function. Mitochondria are sites of aerobic respiration. They produce cellular energy in the form of ATP. Hence, they are called as powerhouse of cells. The matrix also possesses single circular DNA molecule, few RNA molecules, ribosomes which are of 70S type, and the components required for synthesis of proteins. The mitochondria divide by fission. Right? All these points we have learned. Again, diagram of mitochondria, three-dimensional diagram it is given. This can be also asked in test. Plastids. Plastids are found in plant cells and in eugenoids. These are easily observed under microscope as they are large. They bear some specific pigments, thus imparting specific colors to the plants. Based on the pigments, plastids can be classified as chloroplast, chromoplast and leucoplast. The chloroplast contain chlorophyll and carotenoid pigments which are responsible for trapping light energy essential for photosynthesis. In the chromoplast, fat soluble carotenoid pigments like carotene, xanthophyll and others are present. This gives part of the plant yellow, orange or red color. The leucoplasts are the colorless plastids of various shapes and sizes with stored nutrients. Amyloplasts store carbohydrates like starch. So, example, potato, rice, wheat. Next one, leioplasts store oils and fats, whereas alluroplasts store proteins. Majority of chloroplasts of green plants are found in mesophyll cells of leaves. These are lens-shaped, oval, spherical, discoid or even ribbon-like organelle having variable length 5 to 10 micrometer and width 2 to 4 micrometer. Their number varies from 1 per cell, that is in Chlamydomonas, a green alga, to 20 to 40 per cell in mesophyll. Like mitochondria, the chloroplasts are also double membrane bound. Of the two, the inner chloroplast membrane is relatively less permeable. The space limited by inner membrane of chloroplast is called as stroma. A number of organized flattened structure sacs called as thylakoids are present in the stroma. Thylakoids are arranged in stacks like the piles of coins called grana or intergranular thylakoids. In addition, there are flat membranous tubules called stroma lamellae connecting the thylakoids of different grana. The membrane of thylakoid includes a space that is called lumen. The stroma of chloroplasts contain enzymes required for synthesis of carbohydrates and proteins. It also contains small double-stranded circular DNA molecules and ribosomes. Chlorophyll pigments are present in the thylakoids. The ribosomes of chloroplasts are 70S than the cytoplasmic ribosomes which are 80S. Fine. Again, very easy. Aside to this sectional view, 3D sectional view of chloroplast it is given. Next, ribosomes. Ribosomes are granular structures first observed under electron microscope as dense particle by George Palladin in 1953. They are composed of ribonucleic acid and proteins and are not surrounded by any membrane. The eukaryotic ribosomes are 80S, while prokaryotic ribosomes are 70S. Each ribosome has two subunits, larger and smaller subunits. The two subunits of 80S ribosomes are 60S and 40S, while that of 70S ribosomes are 50S and 30S. S it is Swedberg unit, that already we have learned, 1 into 10 raised to minus 13 seconds. Stand for the sedimentation coefficient. It is indirectly a measure of density and size. Both 70S and 80S ribosomes are composed of two subunits. Fine. Sure. Next one, cytoskeleton. An elaborate network of filamentous proteinaceous structure consisting of microtubules, microfilaments, and intermediate filaments present in the cytoplasm, collectively referred as cytoskeleton. The cytoskeleton in a cell are involved in many functions such as mechanical support, motility, maintenance, and shape of cell. Fine. Next one, cilia and flagella. Cilia and flagella are hair-like outgrowths of cell membrane. Cilia are small structures which work like oars, causing the movement of either the cell or the surrounding fluid. Flagella are comparatively longer and responsible for cell movement. The prokaryotic bacteria also possess flagella, but these are structurally different from that of eukaryotic flagella. The electron microscopic study of cilium or flagellum show that they are covered with a plasma membrane. Their core, it is known as axoneum, possesses a number of microtubules running parallel to long axis. The axoneum usually has 9 doublets of radially arranged spherical microtubules and a pair of centrally located microtubules. Such an arrangement of axonal microtubule is referred as 9 plus 2 array. The central tubules are connected by bridges and is also enclosed by a central sheath, which is connected to one of the tubules of each peripheral doublet by a radial spoke. Thus, there are 9 radial spokes. The peripheral doublets are also interconnected by linkers. Both the cilium and flagella emerge from centriole-like structure called as basic body. So again, 8.10 structure of cilia it is given, flagella, sorry. So that also you have to study along with all the labels. Fine. Next one, centrosomes and centrioles. Centrosome is an organelle usually containing two cylindrical structures called as centrioles. They are surrounded by amorphous pericentriolar material. Both the centrioles in a centrosome lie perpendicular to each other, in which each has an organization like a cartwheel. They are made up of 9 evenly placed peripheral fibrils of tubulin protein. Each of the peripheral fibrils is a triplet. The adjacent triplets are also linked. The central part of proximal region of centriole is also proteinaceous, called as hub, which is connected with the tubules of peripheral triplet by radial spokes made up of protein. The centrioles form the basal body of cilia or flagella and spindle fibers that give rise to spindle apparatus during cell division. Fine. Cell division in animal cells. Okay. Next cell organelle, nucleus. Nucleus as a cell organelle was first described by Robert Brown as early in 1831. Later, the material of nucleus stained by the basic dyes were given the name chromatin by Fleming. The interface nucleus, that is nucleus of a cell when it is not dividing, has highly extended and elaborate nucleoprotein fibers called chromatin. Nucleus, nuclear matrix, and one or more spherical bodies called nucleoli. Electron microscopy has revealed that the nuclear envelope, which consists of two parallel membranes with a space between 10 to 50 nanometer, called perinuclear space. Forms a barrier between materials present inside the nucleus and that of cytoplasm. The outer membrane usually remains continuous with the endoplasmic reticulum and also bear ribosomes on it. At a number of places, the nuclear envelope is interrupted by minute pores, which are formed by the fusion of its two membranes. These nuclear pores are the passages through which movement of RNA and protein molecules takes place in both the directions, that is between the nucleus and cytoplasm. Fine, so already we have learned when we discuss the structure of nucleus, there are 1000 to 10,000 nuclear pores through which this mRNA as well as proteins, they are transferred. Normally there is only one nucleus per cell. Variation in number of nuclei are also frequently observed. Some mature cells even lack nucleus, like erythrocytes of many mammals, sieve tubes of vascular plants. The nuclear matrix or nucleoplasm contains the nucleolus and chromatin. The nucleoli are spherical structures present in nucleoplasm. The content of nucleolus is continuous with the rest of the nucleoplasm as it is not a membrane bound structure. It is a site for active ribosomal RNA synthesis. So rRNA is synthesized. Later, larger and more numerous nucleoli are present in cells actively carrying out protein synthesis. So we have learned that nucleoli, they are many as well as larger in size in those cells which are actively involved in protein synthesis. You may recall that the interface nucleus has a loose and indistinct network of nucleoprotein fibers called chromatin. But during different stages of cell division, cells show structural chromosomes in place of the nucleus. Chromatin contains DNA and some basic proteins called histone. Again, for MCQ, this can come. Chromatin, it is composed of what? Chromatin, it is composed of DNA and some basic proteins, that is histones, as well as some non-histone proteins also. And RNA. See, yeah? What composition, what is the composition of chromatin? There is DNA, histone proteins, non-histone proteins, as well as RNA. For MCQ, very important point. A single human cell has approximately 2 meter long thread of DNA distributed among its 46, that is 23 pairs of chromosomes. You will study the detail in 12. Fine. Every chromosome, which is visible only in dividing cells, essentially has a primary constriction or the centromere on the sides of which disc-shaped structures called kinetochores are present. Centromere holds two chromatids of a chromosome. Based on the position of centromere, the chromosomes can be classified into 4 types. The metacentric chromosome has middle centromere, forming 2 equal arms of chromosomes. The submetacentric chromosome has centromere slightly away from the middle of chromosome, resulting in one shorter arm and one longer arm. In case of acrocentric chromosome, the centromere is situated close to its end, forming one extremely short and one very long arm. Whereas telocentric chromosome has terminal centromere. Again, all these 4 types, 4 diagrams of types of chromosomes also important. Fine. Sometimes a few chromosomes have non-staining secondary constriction at a constant location. This gives the appearance of small fragment called satellite. And the last part of this lesson, microbodies. Many membrane bound minute vesicles called microbodies that contain various enzymes are present in both plant cells and animal cells. Fine. So this is about the cell division. After that summary is given, that summary now you are going to read It may happen that one or two points are additionally which are given here, which may not be mentioned in the text. So in this way, you have to read each and every word of NCERT. Try to understand meaning of every statement. Every statement is important. This time you will see, this time paper it is little bit logical. Because already you have given two major tests, now you understood in what way you have to study. So definitely question paper is not easy. So don't be in that mood that question paper will be easy and we will attempt all. If you have read all your notes properly, if you have understood each and every concept, fine. So this is about the cell lesson. Okay, we have completed NCERT also. Now I hope you don't have any problem with NCERT. Still, yesterday I gave you one assignment or one practice sheet to solve. You solve those questions. From Monday, we will start the next lesson, that is cell division. Both the lessons are there for your major test, which is going to held on 5th of July. So cell division, small lesson, but again it is very important lesson. Okay. So from Monday, now we will start the next lesson, that is cell division. Till that, you have to continue solving this sheet. So in between, if you get some doubts, okay, you just message me your doubts, or if you have not understood a particular point, so just send me that doubt. Okay, so that I can take that point in my next lecture, or I can explain that point again. Fine. So this is for the day. We have completed the lesson. Now we will meet on Monday with a new lesson, that is cell cycle and cell division. Okay, fine. So that is all the day. Okay, or that is for the day. In today's lecture, we have taken the revision, or you can say obviously we have revised the lesson with the help of NCERT. So again, you read the lesson, you revise your notes and send your doubts. Fine.